สวัสดีครับ I'm Point from ค้นพบ When we talk about personal development and when we begin to work on ourselves, we'll soon realize that many of these topics that we talk about, they really point back to the fundamentals, which is to learn how to be more aware of your own thoughts, your own thinking patterns, thinking habits, thinking styles, and how these things interplay with your feelings and your emotions and your reactions. In other words, we want to learn how to identify unhelpful thinking styles, unhelpful thoughts, and learn to gradually challenge that, gently but gradually, challenge that to change it from disempowering and unhelpful thoughts to become more positive and more empowering ones, in line with stronger psychological foundations to help us grow as a person, to help us build our self-esteem, reduce our anxiety, and build stronger psychological foundations. So as we've talked about previously, thinking styles and thinking patterns, they really are a thing of a learned habit, right? So you have a certain perspective and a certain outlook on things, on how the world works, how reality works, how your life works. You have a certain perspective about yourself, your sense of self. And that is really tied to your belief system, which as we talked about, is nothing more than a perspective. It's not really reality. It's just the spectacles or the lens that you use to look at and make sense of and understand the world, right? So you're stuck in that perspective and you think about it in that way of line, that line of thinking, that perspective over and over and over again until it becomes a habit in you. But you see, here's the key. Because thinking patterns are nothing more than a habit, and because they're nothing more than pretty much a perspective on how you look at things, then therefore, it can be challenged and it can be changed. And that's the key of today's video. And for the purpose of this video, let's talk about a few unhelpful thinking styles, right? Because if you have strong psychological foundations, a high self-esteem, and low social anxiety, you'll most likely have positive outlooks and a helpful thinking style, right? So what about the negative ones, the unhelpful ones? Number one, a negative thinking style. Here are a few indicators which may show that perhaps you have a negative thinking style, right? Number one, negative thinkers tend to find it quite difficult to have a sense of appreciation and a sense of gratitude or gratefulness for the small things in their life, such as a nice cup of coffee, such as the beautiful weather today, the sun is out, the flowers are blooming, and they find it hard to celebrate with and be grateful for a friend who is happy, right? So a negative thinker always looks at the negative, obviously. They see that things will go wrong. They expect things to go wrong. The glass is always half empty, right? They're always assuming that things will turn out for the worst, things will go bad, this won't work, that won't work, it won't work, I can't find love. They perhaps are paranoid that their girlfriend or boyfriend is gonna leave them, is gonna dump them, right? They find it quite difficult to appreciate the food at a restaurant because they're focused on the bad, such as long waiting time, the food is too salty, the food is too sour, etc. There's always a million things to complain about. Right. Here are, of course, these are a few examples, but the list goes on. So the next question is, why do we have a negative thinking style? What leads to this getting stuck in this style of thinking? One way to look at it is that a negative thinking style is tied to a negative belief system. Right? And as we talked about, a belief system, we must work to uphold and maintain our belief systems because it is the structure that is part of our identity. And we use that as a way to make sense of the world and to understand our relationship with reality, right? So a negative thinker with a negative belief system will selectively look at facts and data in their surrounding environment and interpret things into a meaning that is quite negative to reinforce that negative belief system, right? For example, somebody who just got a sore throat, right? And is a negative thinker, they might say to themselves, oh my God, I have a sore throat. Now I'm bound to get sick. I'm bound to get ill, right? I'm gonna get ill. In a sense, they need to feel that they are proven right because they want to feel that their life is somehow somewhat predictable and they have some sense of control over their life. So in a twisted way, when they do get sick, even though nobody enjoys being sick, but they get a sense of validation that, see, my thinking is proven correct and my negativity is proven correct. So it's justified, right? This leads to the next point, that from a psychological perspective, a negative thinking style is usually associated with high social anxiety. Why is that so? The counterintuitive nature of this is that somebody who has a negative thinking style, they must look at a situation and look for the worst in it. Assume it's going to fail, assume it's not going to work out, assume that the bad is going to happen in order to avoid taking action, correct? Because what they're really doing is they are really avoiding the pain of feeling rejected, the pain of feeling like a failure, or the pain of being judged. So negativity is used to justify, right, the fact that they might as well not try it. They might as well not try to ask for a raise at their workplace. They might as well not try to ask for a promotion at their job. They might as well not try to ask that guy out on a date, that girl out on a date. They might as well not try to start that business of their, you know, dreams. Because, you know, we don't know how things are going to be like. And because reality is so negative and so bad, things are bound to go wrong, right? So why even try it? But really, the thing that's hidden underneath there is that they fear failure, they fear judgment, and they fear rejection. So this is tied to a weak psychological foundation, an external sense of power and control over your experiences. In other words, they don't really believe that they have the capabilities or the ability to influence the experiences and the outcomes of their life, the quality of their life, right? So this negative thinking style can be seen as closely associated to high social anxiety. And also in another twisted way, somebody who has a negative thinking style, right, they use that as a way to justify feeling negative, feeling a negative emotion, and to justify not taking any responsibility or not taking any action, as just stated. Right? Because when you feel, when you have a narrative where things are negative, things are bound to go wrong, things are bound to go bad, you develop this sort of victim relationship to that event or that experience or to that somebody, right? And you feel a sense of a moral high ground in your position, right? But that's really all it is. It's done, this thinking style is done, or is used to avoid the fear of failure, the fear of judgment, and the fear of rejection. That's really all it boils down to. So with this in mind, how do you step out of it, right? How do you get out of this negative thinking style? First of all, realize that this negative thinking style, it just comes from a negative belief system. And as we talked about, a belief system can be challenged because it's nothing more than a perspective on things. It's nothing more than your outlook on reality, your outlook on the world. So by gently challenging your negative thinking, try to downplay the negativity. Try to see that it is your choice to think in a negative light, and you therefore have a choice to choose a more neutral way of thinking or a more positive way of thinking. Try to look for the positives in a situation. By the way, research has shown this, that for example, cancer patients, even children who have cancer, which is objectively one of the worst things that we can probably experience, right? Cancer. Somebody who has cancer, but yet can still find a positive thing to appreciate or to feel gratitude for in that negative experience, right? They actually have higher recovery rates. They actually have higher survival chances. So it really does show that that positivity is really important, and that you can learn to reduce the negative thinking style by looking for the positives in the experience, no matter how negative it is. Because the studies work from cancer patients who were able to find something positive in that objectively difficult experience and objectively horrible experience, right? Okay, so the next thinking style is what's known as the brooding thinking style, also known as obsessive thinking style. And this may also be closely tied to a negative thinking style, right? And personally, this is one that I struggle with in some areas of my life. So I want to take time to talk about it. A person who is obsessive in their thinking may have the following indicators. Number one, they frequently think and worry about something over and over and over and over and over again. Another indicator is they find it hard to sleep at night. In other words, they lose sleep over these thoughts and these worries that play in their mind over and over and over and over again. Somebody who is an obsessive thinker may feel anxiety if they don't think that they are in control of the situation, right? If they don't think that they are on top of things, then they will feel anxious and they don't want to tolerate that. They want to avoid that feeling, right? Somebody who is an obsessive thinker may overanalyze a situation, right? And they may take a long time to consider something before making a decision about it. So in that regard, brooding or obsessive thinking is about control. Somebody who is an obsessive thinker, really, what it really boils down to is they want to have control over that situation, over that somebody in their life, over that event in their life, over that experience in their life. How does this work? Okay, say you have an event that you're trying to make some sense of, right? You have a thought about that event, but this thought plays over and over and over again hundreds of times, and you think about that event, say for example, you got rejected, right? From asking a guy or a girl out on a date, and you got rejected, right? You play that thought over and over and over again from all possible angles, right? So in this sense, number one, that rejection in this regard, it replays itself in your mind hundreds of times. Now you're stressed, you have stressful thoughts, and you try to analyze it from all possible angles, right? Because why? Because you want to feel that you have some sense of understanding and some sense of control over the situation. Again, obsessive thinking is about a sense of control. You want to have control over the situation. You want to feel that you understand what's going on and that you can therefore make some sort of peace or conclusion or make a decision, right? But ironically, overanalyzing it only adds more confusion to the situation and a sense of powerlessness, okay? And now you're stuck with these unhelpful thoughts, and you actually maintain the symptoms of anxiety and make it worse rather than making it better. So it may seem like overthinking is a way to get some control over it, or a way to promote an internal sense of control, an internal sense of power and control over your experiences, but actually it only promotes more anxiety, right? Compared to somebody who may be who may have just faced that rejection, but is not an obsessive thinker, right? They will get hurt. Rejection hurts, but they'll be able to move on from it rather quickly, especially if they have the support and care from somebody who they're close to and who they can trust and who can reassure and validate their self-esteem for them, right? But an obsessive thinker cannot do that, which shows the irony of the situation. A lot of times we tend to think that if we're stuck with a dilemma, we must look inwards and analyze the situation over and over again to get some sense of internal control over it. But actually, you're only promoting a bigger sense of externality for yourself, right? So what is the way out from obsessive thinking? Here's one proposal. First of all, realize that your obsessive thinking is nothing more than your desire to feel in control and your desire to feel on top of things. And therefore, it is a choice that you're making, so you can choose to stop. Stop what you're doing, stop what you're thinking, take a step back, gain some perspective, and see how overanalyzing it is not helping you solve the problem. And sometimes some situations don't have a solution, right? So realize that. Gain perspective and choose to let it go. Because obsessive people, what they're really stuck on is they're stuck on the fact that they can't let it go and they can't move on. And if this, you know, these ideas don't work, try stopping what you're doing and changing what you're doing. Change your activity. Take your mind off something for now, right? Be fully present and engage in a more productive activity, right? So that you give yourself time to stop overthinking about that situation that you're stuck on. Okay. So the third unhelpful thinking style is black and white thinking style. Again, I also used to have problems with this one, especially in my earlier years. So what is the black and white thinking style? A black and white thinking style is one where you look at things in absolute terms. There's no middle ground. There's no gray area. You can't tolerate uncertainty. You always think in extremes. You always have a strong opinion on something, and things always need to be clear to you, right? For example, an indicator is you either really like somebody or you really dislike that person. You really think something is really bad or you think something is really good. There's no middle ground. And you may use words like always, ever, totally, completely, never, impossible, something like that. These are some words that may indicate a black and white thinking style. But a black and white thinking style, it really boils down to the fact that the person who has a black and white thinking style, they really dislike uncertainty. So that's why they are rigid in their thinking. They always feel attached to the need to feel certain about something, to make some sense of understanding and control over the situation. So similar to obsessive thinking style, they also have a desire for control over their understanding of the situation, right? So they dislike uncertainty and they dislike feeling anxiety. In other words, somebody with a black and white thinking style, also known as all or nothing thinking style, they find it rather difficult to tolerate anxiety and uncertainty. For example, say you have a choice about whether or not to go to a party. You might think along the lines, if you are a black and white thinker, that nobody's gonna like me at the party anyways, the party's not gonna be fun, so I might as well not go, right? Because what's going on here? They think along that lines to make a decision about not going because they want to feel certain about their sense of self. They want to feel certain that they're not gonna face any anxiety, and you don't face anxiety if you don't go, so you might as well not go. But the irony is, this over time, it builds your externality. It makes you feel a more external sense of power and control, because although in the short run, you feel more in control that you don't have to face anxiety, but ultimately, this only builds your fear of social situations, social context, and therefore social anxiety. Another example of a black and white thinking style is this. Say you're at work and your boss criticizes a piece of your work. Right away, you think immediately, oh my God, my boss must hate me. My work must be shit. I must be so horrible at this job. I must never get a promotion. So it's rather very extreme very quickly, right? So what is the way out? First of all, the key is about tolerance. As we just discussed just now, people with a black and white thinking style find it rather difficult to tolerate uncertainty and anxiety. That's why they may fear, for example, a plane ride, always thinking that the worst is gonna happen, the turbulence is gonna, you know, it's gonna be doomsday turbulence on this flight. They may have an anxious feeling when waiting for the dentist, etc. So what you want to do is you want to realize that the fear comes from within you, and therefore you can, you know, overcome it. You can learn from it. You can grow out of the fear by gradually putting yourself in situations that have some small element of anxiety in it. Tell yourself, if you're waiting at the dentist and you're anxious, that take a deep breath, calm down, you can tolerate this, you can get through this, it's not going to be the end of the world, it's not going to be horrible, you're going to get better, right? And try to go through the experience mindfully and learn and realize that, hey, it wasn't as bad as you had feared, right? So you want to build up tolerance in order to counter black and white thinking style. Now, as you've noticed throughout this video, we've talked about the downside of these thinking styles, right? And just to be clear, you know, a black and white thinking style and even an obsessive thinking style can have positives to it. But the assumption that I'm making in this video is that if you have a combination of low self-esteem and external sense of power and control over your experiences, in other words, you feel powerless to influence the experiences and the outcomes of the things in your life, right? The events in your life. And if you have high social anxiety, these thinking styles combined with those factors will produce a rather disempowering outcome. You'll only create more stress and anxiety for yourself. So, you know, we've talked about the negatives, so let's talk about some positives. A positive for somebody with low social anxiety, high self-esteem, and an internal sense of power and control who has an obsessive thinking style are, guess what? They're usually inventors, right? Because anything that was invented, most things that were invented, say the camera that I'm using to film this video on, or the computer, the laptop that I need to use to do the editing, right? Those inventions come from somebody who was very obsessed with their dreams, with their invention. They were able to focus on it for so long, over and over and over and over and over again, despite the fact that other people may look at them as crazy or may not understand them. Think about Thomas Edison, the person who invented the light bulb. He failed hundreds and hundreds, almost 1,000 times. But when asked about his failure, he flipped it on his head. He didn't say he failed 100 times. He didn't say he failed 1,000 times. He said that he found hundreds and 1,000 ways in which this light bulb would not work. See? So he was able to obsess over the invention of a light bulb, despite the fact that other people may think he's crazy. So, you know, again, obsessive thinking style can be a good thing, but that's only in combination with a positive outlook and internal sense of power and control over your experiences. In other words, strong psychological foundations, low social anxiety, and high self-esteem. Black and white thinking also has positives to it, because the moment somebody commits to something in black and white thinking, they'll go all in, they'll go 100%. So let's say a black and white thinker commits to working on an anxiety problem, then they will really follow through that commitment because of the black and white thinking. So there are positives, but we want to learn how to identify the negative sides, the disempowering ones, or the unhelpful thoughts, to better learn how to manage them and to gradually but gently challenge them to become more positive, to become more empowering, and to help promote stronger psychological foundations. So that's what I want to share in today's video, these three unhelpful thinking styles. If you like this video, please leave a like for me, please share the video for me, and please subscribe to my channel. If you're watching this on YouTube, hit the bell button for more videos, or like my page if you're watching this video on Facebook. And also please leave in the comments which thinking style you found resonated with you most. And why was it so? How do you deal with these thinking styles? And how does it work for you when you have to learn to manage them, right? I want to hear your thoughts. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time. สวัสดีครับ